Good morning, everyone. Let's begin with a word of prayer. If someone here in the hall can kindly start with a word of prayer, we'll have our session after that.
Heavenly Father, I thank you, Jesus, Father, for this time, Lord, Father, that you have given us to study, Abba, Father. Your servant speaks to us, Father. You speak to our heart, I pray, Abba, Father. And Lord, let your word remain in our heart, I pray, Abba, Father. You equip us, Father, through your word, Father. And inspire us, Father, through your word, I pray, Father. Full session I give into hand, Lord. Take care of our lives. In Jesus' mighty name I pray, Father. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah. So today we will cover the book of Judges, which we were unable to do last time. So the book of Judges talks about how after the death of Joshua and the death of the elders, you know, who had entered the promised land and seen the Lord giving them victory in all the different places. So after that entire generation passed away, the next generation failed to stay faithful to the Lord. And so we see Israel kind of losing their first love for Yahweh, and they begin to backslide. And then we see the consequences of their sin, you know, because wherever sin comes in and begins to rule and reign, it brings destruction along with it. So we see the downfall of these people. God had great plans for them in this promised land. He brought them here with great and grand promises. He wanted nothing but good for them. But then when they chose to abandon him, when they chose to turn their back on his ways, it led to the opposite of what God had wanted. They began to experience failure and oppression from the locals and many other bad consequences which followed. And from Acts 13:20, we get to know that this period of the judges lasted 450 years. That's quite a long time, you know, that they went through this cycle of defeat and oppression and struggle. So the assumption generally is that during this entire period of the judges, leaders and scribes would have recorded, maintained a written record of all the events which are taking place, and then through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, someone would have put together all of those records in an orderly manner and finally compiled the book of Judges. So we are not really sure how many people were involved in this process, but different people would have been inspired to jot down certain details and keep them ready. And then later, maybe during the time of Samuel, maybe Samuel himself would have compiled these records into a proper organized flow of information, and that would have resulted in the book of Judges. So coming to the structure of this book, we could divide Judges into three main sections. The first would be all the way from chapter 1 up to chapter 3, verse 6. That's a rather odd place to break right in the middle of the chapter, I know. But that is where you have the introductory failure of these people described. So from chapter 1 up to chapter 3, verse 6, it gives us a description of the failure, how they failed and what caused the failure. And then chapter 3, verse 7 onwards, all the way up to chapter 16, you will have a list of judges and their achievements. So there are totally 14 judges mentioned. Now, 14 judges actually would not fit into 450 years, you know, if each of them led as a leader throughout their lifetime. So we have to assume that maybe one or two judges would have been leading simultaneously in different portions of the promised land. Okay, so there are 14 judges mentioned, But it's quite likely that a few of those judges would have been ruling simultaneously in different portions of the promised land. So that would be chapter 3, verse 7, all the way up to chapter 16, where the rule of these judges, the leadership of these judges is described. And then the last section would be chapters 17 to 21, where you have the sin of idolatry, and it goes beyond just the sin of idolatry into all kinds of other sins in this last section, where morality is lost, where the sense of right and wrong is lost, where the entire Israelite society almost becomes dehumanized, not even behaving human anymore. You know, so all of that takes place in this last section. So you could maybe call it the greater failure, the progressive failure of these people. So let's begin actually with the account of their introductory failure, which led to all of this downfall. We will look at two passages which bring out where the failure lay, what was the cause of it. So the first passage, it would be good, if you already have your Bibles ready in front of you, opened to the book of Judges. So if we could have someone read out for us Judges chapter 1, verses 19 to 21. Judges 1, 19 to 21, please.
So the Lord was with Judah, and they drove out the mountaineers, but they could not drive out the inhabitants of the lowland because they had chariots of iron. And they gave Hebron to Cabel, as Moses had said. Then he expelled from there the three sons of Anok. But the children of Benjamin did not drive out of the Jebusites who inhabited Jerusalem. So the Jebusites dwell with the children of Benjamin in Jerusalem to this day.
It says over here in this passage that the Lord was with the men of Judah. It's not that the Lord was not with them. The Lord was with them. And yet, they were unable to drive out the people from the plains. Why? What is the reason they were unable to do this even though the Lord was with them? Because that enemy, they had chariots fitted with iron. You know, because in those days, you basically had wooden chariots, which probably would not have functioned that well. But then by this time, they had iron fittings, added to the wheels of the chariots to make the wheels move more smoothly. So these chariots fitted with iron moved faster. They were able to achieve more in battle. So does this mean that if the chariots are made of iron, or rather fitted with iron, does it mean that having the Lord with you is not enough? I mean, are those iron-fitted chariots so powerful and great that the Lord's presence, in fact, doesn't help anymore? So what is the problem over here? It says that because of those iron-fitted chariots, these people were unable to drive out the locals the way the Lord had asked them to do. In fact, it goes on then to describe, each tribe. For instance, over here in verse 21, it talks about the Benjamites, how they were unable to drive out the Jebusites from their territory. So what happened finally? They were unable to drive out the Jebusites. The Jebusites continued to live over there in their homes. And so the Benjamites had to coexist with them in the same territory. That is what happened. And then as you go through the rest of the first chapter, it talks about each tribe and how they were unable to drive out the people in their respective territories. So it's a rather sad state of affairs. God had promised them great victory. And it says over here that the Lord was with them. But just because there were some chariots out there with iron fittings, the people were unable to overcome. So what exactly is the issue here? Let's go to chapter 2, Judges chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. And here we will see the reason why they are unable to overcome. So if someone could read out for us, Judges chapter 2, verses 1 to 4.
The angel
then
of the
angel
Lord
of the
went
Lord
up to
came
Gilgal
from
to book.
Gilgal to Bochim and said, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars, but you have not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? Therefore, I also said, I will not drive them out before you, but they shall be thorns in your sight, and the gods shall be as near to you. So it was when the angel of the Lord spoke those words to all the children of Israel that the people lifted up their voices and wept.
And verse 5, yes, verse 5 as well, please.
Okay. Then they called the name of the place Bochim, and they sacrificed there to the Lord.
So the people of Israel also must have been wondering, why are we unable to gain victory? And the explanation lies over here. The Lord says, when I brought you, I said to you, I will never break my covenant with you. So the Lord kept his covenant with them. The Lord was with them to help them gain victory. But what did the people do? The Lord says over here in verse 2, Judges chapter 2, verse 2. He said to them that they shall not make a covenant with the people of this land, but that they should break down their altars. And the Lord says, yet you have disobeyed me. And the Lord says, because you have disobeyed me, he says, I will not drive them out before you. So you see, the people went into their territories with a heart that was willing to compromise. Their attitude was, let's try to defeat them. But then they got chariots fitted with iron. So in case we're unable to defeat them, fine, you know, we'll come into some kind of agreement with them. Let us coexist. Let them keep their altars, their way of worship. We'll adjust. They went into this whole idea of conquest with that compromising mentality, where they had decided that they would adjust. But look at what, you know, Caleb, the 80-year-old man, did with his, you know, the territory assigned to him. You know, if you were to go back to your chapter 1, where it talks about those chariots fitted with iron, it talks about that in your verses 19, 20, 21. But then when you look at verse 20 and read about Caleb, for Caleb, it didn't matter whether the chariots were fitted with iron or whether the people whom he had to fight with were giants. Because it says over there in verse 20 in chapter 1, as Moses had promised, Hebron was given to Caleb, who drove from it the three sons of Anak. The sons of Anak were actually giants. So their army would have been in a far more, you know, powerful state. But they were, you know, they were not able to withstand Caleb, because Caleb had an undivided heart. He has decided that he will honor the Lord and keep his ways, and there is no room for compromise. He is willing to die if he has to die, but he is going to fight them till his last breath. He is not going to compromise. He is not going to adjust. On the other hand, we see these tribes, the other tribes, going in, and they do not break down the altars of the people, of the locals. They, in fact, enter into covenants with the locals. And therefore, the Lord finally says, I will not drive them out before you. They will become traps for you, and their gods will become snares to you. And when the Lord passes his judgment, it says that the people wept aloud. And that place was named Bochim, which literally means weepers, the place, you know, the place of weepers. So this is a very vital, important lesson for us to learn. It doesn't matter how many iron fittings the chariots have, which we are facing. If we go in to our battles with the idea that there is not going to be any compromise, no, Lord, your way and your way alone. If I have to literally perish and be a complete living sacrifice, so be it. But no compromise, O Lord. I will continue to fight and resist until I come out victorious to honor you and you alone. No adjustment, no compromise. People with that kind of a Caleb attitude can even take down giants. Because giants or iron-fitted chariots are nothing once you have the Lord on your side. But the Lord can be on your side only if there is no compromise, because he will keep his side of the covenant. But are you willing to, you know, observe your side of the covenant? These people, instead of observing their side of the covenant, they decided to go and make a covenant with the locals. What a terrible compromise, which is why this is what it says in the New Testament, in James chapter 4, verses 7 to 10. It's a very good learning can be, you know, had from this. James 4, verses 7 to 10, if someone could read out. James 4, 7 to 10.
Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up.
What good godly advice is given here. The very first step to overcoming is, step one is not resisting the devil. Step one is submitting yourself to God. Step two is resisting the devil. Once you are in submission to God, resisting the devil becomes easier. You will have victory. You will be able to resist. You will be able to overcome. So step one is submission to the Lord. That is where these Israelites failed. They went in with this attitude of compromise where they were like, okay, if we can do it, fine. If we can't, we'll make an agreement with them and adjust. We'll work out some kind of, you know, agreement with them. No, they did not submit to the Lord. That was such a big mistake. Once, step one, if you submit to the Lord and say, Lord, I am not going to back off. I will do whatever it takes to honor you and you alone. Then resisting the devil becomes possible, and the devil in fact will have to flee, because you are in submission to the Almighty God, and he cannot stand against God. He can't. So that is why the advice is given: come near to God and he will come near to you. So if we are in a position of loss and defeat, the right thing to do is to wash our hands. Purify our hearts from double-mindedness, where you are single-minded and you say to the Lord, Lord, I worship you and honor you and obey you, and I refuse to even consider other options. No double-mindedness. And that is the advice given over here in James 4. And it goes on to say in verse 10, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. So even when they were in that defeated condition, if they had just humbled themselves before the Lord, he would have lifted them up. Okay, so that was the great failing which we see regarding these people. And another thing to observe is that, if you remember when we were doing the book of Numbers, we talked about the various passages where it talks about teaching your children, you know, the ways of Yahweh. In Numbers, there are in multiple places. Again and again, the Lord repeats and commands, saying, please teach your children the ways of Yahweh. But when we see over here in Judges chapter 2, verse 7, and also verses 10 to 11, we see that the elders have failed to do that. So if we could have someone read out for us, Judges chapter 2, verse 7. And also verses 10 and 11, please.
So the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord, which he had done for Israel. When all the generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation arose from after them who did not know the Lord, nor the work which he had done for Israel.
11.
Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals.
So why did these people do evil in the eyes of the Lord and serve the Baals? Because this was a generation who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. What was wrong with that earlier generation? I mean, what was wrong with them? Why didn't they train up their children in the ways of Yahweh after being advised again and again and again. You know, maybe they were too busy with other conquests. They had no time for training up the younger generation. So let that not happen for the people sitting here in this room. May you all be very godly parents who will take this task of training up your children in the way of the Lord very seriously, because the training which you impart will determine their future. Yes, you may turn them into, you know, successful businessmen and software engineers, but then are you also going to turn them into people, men and women of God, who will submit to the Lord and make no compromise? Because then they will succeed in spiritual things and eternal things of lasting value, and you will have the joy of seeing them raised high in the eyes of Yahweh, not just in the eyes of the world. So, you know, it's a failing which we see on the part of these people, which also contributed to the complete mess which we see in the book of Judges. So this is a cycle of sin and repentance which happens again and again, and I think it is 6 times that it is mentioned, the cycle of, you know, the people going into idolatry, and then the Lord brings oppression upon them through enemies, and then they cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, please save us, and then the Lord raises up a leader, a judge, to deliver them, and so they are faithful for the lifetime of that judge, and once the judge dies, they go back into sin once again, go back into idolatry, again the Lord brings oppression upon them through enemies, and the cycle repeats itself. So we see this happening again and again. Maybe we could just read one passage pertaining to this. Judges chapter 3, verses 7 to 9, please. Judges 3, 7 to 9.
The Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asherahs. The anger of the Lord burned against Israel, so that he sold them into the hands of Shushan, Rishathaim, king of Aram, Naharaim, to whom the Israelites were subject for 8 years. But when they cried out to the Lord, he raised up from them and delivered Othniel, son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, who saved them.
So this is just one example of those six times which the cycle is mentioned. Of course, the cycle happened many more times over those 450 years. But then this is the first time that this cycle of sin and repentance is mentioned. So it talks about how the people chose to serve other gods, the Baals and the Asherahs. And then what is the Lord's response? It says the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies. And so when the enemies began to oppress them, it says that they cried out to the Lord. And when they cried out to the Lord was compassionate once more, and he raised up a deliverer for them. And this cycle kept repeating and repeating. But there's something more that we need to observe. It's not just a cycle which is repeating at the same level. There's something worse happening over here. We see that in Judges chapter 2, verse 19, a very significant verse. Judges 2, verse 19, if someone could read out.
But when the judge died, the people returned to ways even more corrupt than those of their ancestors, following other gods and serving and worshipping them. They refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways.
We see here that it's not just that the people went back into the sin of idolatry. They did things which were more corrupt than the generation before them. So it got worse as time went by. Each time they went back, the backsliding was that much, you know, farther down the slope. So each time that cycle got repeated, the people were not sinning at the same level. Now they were sinning at a deeper level. So the corruption level began to increase and increase as time went by, because each generation tried to be even more corrupt than the previous generation. So which is why in the book of Judges, by the time we reach the, you know, the higher failure of the last few chapters, we don't even recognize them as humans anymore. I mean, their behavior is so horrible. I wonder whether even the heathens were behaving as badly as, you know, as these Israelites were behaving in the last few chapters. So we see two things mainly. Of course, for the first is the idolatry which was taking place. And that one of the main reasons for that is seen in Judges chapter 3, verse 6. So if someone could read out Judges chapter 3, verse 6.
And they took their daughters to be their wives and give their daughters to their sons. And they served their gods.
So it starts off by like that in the beginning of Judges, in chapter 3. The Lord very clearly said that they are not to intermarry with the locals. But here you have them happily giving their daughters in marriage and also taking pagan women as brides for their sons. So they started doing this. As a result of that, they automatically began to serve the other gods. And so it continues to increase, you know, this intermarrying and idol worship continues to increase as time goes by, till finally, when we come to the book of Judges chapter 18, verses 22 to 24, we see a very shocking statement. Let's actually just read those few verses and then we'll kind of look at the background of that. Judges chapter 18, verses 22 to 24.
When they were a good way from the house of Micah, then the man who were in the houses near Micah's house gathered together and overtook the children of Dan. And they called out the children of Dan, so they turned around and said to Micah, "What ails you, that you have gathered such a company?" So he said, "You had taken away my God, which I made, and the priest, and you have gone away. Now what more do I have? How can you say to me, 'What ails you?'"
Okay. So here, just for us to, you know, those of us who may not be familiar with this story, this is the story of a man named Micah from the tribe of Ephraim. He decides to make idols for himself, probably because he doesn't think that Yahweh is good enough for him. Silly man. So you have Micah making idols for himself. And then he asks a Levite, you know, Levites who are supposed to be dedicated to Yahweh. He asks a Levite whether he will become his household priest and, you know, help him in worshiping these idols. And the Levite says, yes, of course. And so you have a Levite who is helping an Ephraimite in worshiping idols. And then in the meantime, you have this bunch of Danites, you know, from the tribe of Dan. They have been unable to conquer the territory which belongs to them, because the Amorites have decided to sit stubbornly over there, and these people do not have the Lord on their side. So they're unable to drive out the Amorites. So what to do now? They're not able to fit into the territory. They're a large tribe, and they're not able to fit into the territory which is left to them by the Amorites, because the Amorites have nicely established themselves. They're given one small portion to these people. They're not able to fit. So they decide that they will go against God's will and go to another place and conquer another place which has not been legitimized by the Lord. The Lord has not granted them permission to go and occupy Laish. But they decide, let's go there and attack and occupy that place, even though the Lord has not given us permission to do that. But they're scared to do it on their own. They need a God to help them. So they think, good, let's steal this Micah's idols. So they go to Micah's home. They steal his idols. They also steal his priest, you know, his Levite priest. And they take them and start going away. Micah is very, very upset that his idols and his priest have been kidnapped and taken by the Danites. So he goes chasing after them along with all his neighbors. And then the Danites say, what's the matter with you? Why are you chasing after us and, you know, acting like as if the world is ending? This is what Micah says. He says, you took the gods I made and my priest and went away. What else do I have? How can you say, what's the matter with you? You know, Micah's world has ended because his idols and his priest are gone. I mean, where's the common sense of this man? What else do I have is what he says. He has the, yes, Yahweh, the Almighty God. If he will just repent and turn to the Lord, he doesn't even need the idols or that, you know, that priest, Levite priest who's gone so far away from worshiping the Lord. And the man says, what else do I have? The level of blindness to which they have been reduced. So it all started in chapter 3, where they began to intermarry with the locals and the idol worship started. And now by the time you come to this chapter 18, they don't even know the power of Yahweh anymore. And for them, it's like the world has ended if their idols are taken away. I mean, what happened to this nation of Israel, which was supposed to be a treasured possession of the Lord? What have they done to themselves? So you see, it's not just a small compromise which they made. It led them down a pathway which took them to a stage where they do not even know right from wrong. And they are so blind. They're as blind as the world. This was supposed to be a nation which would set an example for the rest of the nations, and the rest of the nations would look at them and think, oh my, the way they live and the way their God is blessing them, there must be something special about their God. They were supposed to set that kind of an example. But now, I think they're probably in a worse state than the heathen nations around them. Probably the other heathen nations look at them and they think, oh my goodness, thank goodness we're not as bad as them. What a tragedy. I mean, imagine what this would have done to the heart of God, how he must have felt. So we can be just as foolish. It begins with a small compromise and you may think, oh, how bad is it? I mean, after all, you know, we are adjusting with these local people. Let's at least, intermarry with them. It starts off with one compromise. But by the time you get to chapter 18, this man is saying, what else do I have? I'm in such a helpless state because my idols are gone. What foolishness. So it begins with a small compromise. But, you know, if you do not go back to him, that is why in James chapter 4, oh, what wise verse it says. If you're sinning, wash your hands. If you're double-minded, please purify your heart. Please humble yourself before him now, you know, while you still have a chance, so that he may lift you up, so that you don't end up where the people of the book of Judges ended up. Another thing that we see is the complete lack of morality, which happens as time goes by. You know, like I said earlier, they literally get dehumanized. They don't behave like humans anymore. They start behaving like animals. Deuteronomy 12, verse 31, if someone could read out. Deuteronomy, we're looking at Deuteronomy, chapter 12, verse 31, if someone could read out.
You shall not worship the Lord your God in that way. For every abomination to the Lord which he hates, they have done to their gods. For they burn even their sons and daughters in fire to their gods.
This is something which the Lord warns them about in the book of Deuteronomy. He says, please, you know, you must never worship Yahweh the way these pagan nations worship their gods. Because when they worship their pagan gods, they do all kinds of detestable things the Lord hates. That's the way they worship their gods. So he says to the nation of Israel, you must never worship the living God in that way, because these horrible people, they burn their sons and daughters as sacrifices to their gods. And that is something detestable in the eyes of the Lord. It's something that the Lord hates. But then when you come over here to the book of Judges, you see one of the leaders, you know, whom God chooses. It's really sad. In the book of Judges, the Lord is forced to use the most pathetic human beings as leaders because he's not able to find anyone of quality, of character. He chooses a man named Jephthah to lead the people, you know, out of oppression. And what does this Jephthah do? He's scared to go into battle. And so he makes a promise, the kind of promise which the Canaanites make to their gods. He says, Lord, whatever, you know, if you give me victory, whatever comes out of my house, I will give it to you as a burnt offering. He's talking about human sacrifice over here. You're not going to have a puppy running out of the door. It's going to be a human who's going to come out of the door when, you know, when he comes back victorious. He very well knows what he's talking about. He's talking about a human sacrifice. Just like the Canaanites, you know, when they were in desperate situations, when they desperately needed success in war, they were willing to sacrifice their children in the hope that the idol will grant them victory. And this man is adopting that same attitude. He's adopting the detestable practice which the Lord hates. And he's saying, Lord, whatever comes out of my door first, I will give it to you as a burnt offering. Shame on him for having that kind of a, you know, for even assuming that Yahweh would want a sacrifice like that. You know, so these people are so blind and they're so immoral in their ways that they are willing to even sacrifice humans. Of course, you know, to his shock, it's his daughter who comes out and that complicates the matter. We don't really know whether, you know, he finally sacrifices her or not, because there is a lot of scholarly debate going on about the verses which talk about that. We'll not go over there. But the point is, he was willing to do that. A burnt offering is not an offering where, you know, you just offer something in front of God and take it back to your home. No, a burnt offering is one where you burn everything on the altar. The sacrifice dies on the altar. He knew very well what he's talking about. He was talking about human sacrifice over there. That is the level to which these, leaders had got reduced, you know, in this time. So why on earth would God use somebody like that? Let's look at Isaiah chapter 45, verses 1 and 2. Isaiah 45, 1 and 2.
Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to nations before him, and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors, so that the gates will not shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron.
In these verses, the Lord is saying to his anointed one, to Cyrus, he's saying to him, you know, that the Lord is going to hold his right hand. And the Lord says, I will go before you and will level the mountains. I will break down gates of bronze and cut through bars of iron. The Lord is promising this Cyrus that he is going to grant him great victory and success. But please note, this person, Cyrus, was not a follower of Yahweh. He was not a believer in the true living God. He was just an instrument that the Lord was using for his own purposes. Cyrus was a highly ambitious man, a highly self-centered man who wanted to become the most powerful ruler in the world. And so he adopted certain international policies which would make it possible for him to gain popularity among all the nations and be able to achieve, you know, the kind of status that he wanted to achieve. So the Lord took this man, the Lord took his selfishness, and the Lord used his selfishness for his own divine purposes. So it does not indicate over here that the Lord approved of Cyrus' methods and attitudes. It does not at all say anywhere that the Lord approved of Cyrus' strategies. The Lord used his selfish strategies to bring his people back from exile. So he was just an instrument that the Lord used. And we can apply the same principle to the judges in the book of Judges. They were not godly people. Most of them, if you look at their lifestyle, if you look at the decisions they took, they were not godly people. God used their selfishness for his own divine purposes, because the people cried out in their pain for deliverance, and the Lord was merciful. The Lord used whatever was available, and he used imperfect people to deliver those people for a period of time until, of course, they went back into their idolatry. Okay, so in the same way that Cyrus' selfish ambitions were used to deliver the Israelites and bring them back from exile, in the same way, the Lord also used the selfish ambitions of Samson. The Lord did not approve of Samson's ways, but the Lord used this selfish, self-centered man for his own purposes. Let's look at a verse which actually brings out that. Judges chapter 14, verses 3 and 4. Judges 14, verses 3 and 4, please.
Then his father and mother said to him, "Is there no woman among the daughters of your brethren or among all my people that you must go and get a wife from the uncircumcised Palestinians?" And Samson said to his father, "Get her for me, for she pleases me well." But his father and mother did not know that it was of the Lord that he was seeking an occasion to move against the Philistines, for at that time the Philistines had dominion over Israel.
The problem with Samson was that he was so self-centered that even though he knew that from birth he had been dedicated to the Lord, he was not interested in fulfilling the Lord's purposes. He was supposed to go and fight the Philistines, but this man was too busy thinking about himself and his own love life and, you know, his own interests. And so when he decides that he is going to marry this Philistine woman, his parents say, "Why on earth do you want to marry a Philistine? Aren't there good women among our own community? Why on earth do you want to go and marry a pagan?" And then it says over there in verse 4, his parents did not know that this was from the Lord. So the Lord had decided that the only way to use this man is to use his selfish ambitions. So the Lord, you know, allows that marriage to take place. And as a result of that, you know, Samson loses his temper. He gets angry. And because he's selfishly angry, he decides to fight against the Philistines. Not because he cares about the people and wants to deliver them. Not because he cares at all about God's purposes. So God is forced to use selfish, self-centered characters for his own divine purposes. Which is why when we are living in a corrupt world, you know, that the kind of world that we are living in today, where the church is coming under attack and we have all kinds of powerful, influential leaders who are actually anti-church, who are anti-believers, and such people are ruling and reigning in our countries, no problem. The Lord knows even how to use such people as his instruments to accomplish his divine purposes, and no one can stand in his way. So let the church not feel depressed, you know, that, oh, that we have such ungodly leaders in positions of power. No problem. The Lord knows, the Lord has a lot of experience in this field. He knows how to use even the corrupt and the evil ones for his divine purposes. So no purpose of the Lord will ever be thwarted. What the Lord wants, he will fulfill, he will accomplish. That is the confidence, you know, that we can have. So therefore, even when we are in the midst of persecution and oppression at the hands of powerful leaders, we can rejoice and worship him because he is seated on the throne and nobody can defeat him. He laughs at these leaders who think that they are working against the church and succeeding. You know, so that is the kind of God that we worship. We see a little bit of that displayed in the book of Judges, where the Lord had to use people like this. Just to touch upon another aspect of this, that we are not left with doubts in our mind. You know, Hebrews chapter 11, verses 32 and 33. Hebrews 11, 32 and 33, if someone could read out.
"And what more shall I say? For the time would fill Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also to the David and Samuel and the prophets, who taught the faith, subverted kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions."
Okay, you know, Hebrews 11 is generally called the the hallway of faith. What is the term? Can't seem to. Hall of faith, yeah. So these are supposed to be the, you know, the faith giants. But please look at the names listed over here. You know, if we were to go into the book of Judges, we would see many imperfections in these people's lives. It says about them that through faith they conquered kingdoms, administered justice, gained what was promised. So we are only supposed to imitate that one aspect of their lives, where through faith they were able to achieve what God had planned. Please do not imitate any other aspect of their lives, because their lives were really fallen, horrible examples. Okay? Over here, only one aspect of their life is being highlighted and held up for us to admire, and that is their faith, where God said, you will be able to overcome these powerful guys. And they said, okay, fine, we'll try. And they tried. Okay, so they're being commended for the faith which they put. For instance, Samson, you know, he's like really angry that, you know, they've made him into a slave and they've chained him. And, you know, they're asking him to perform for them so that they can mock him. And so he's standing over there between two pillars. And the man exercises his faith and he says, Lord, I know you will help me to, you know, to bring down these pillars. So he did have faith to believe that the living God can do this for him. But even that one act which he did it for selfish reasons to kind of take revenge against those people who are mocking him, not because he wanted to honor God. So imitate them in the faith which they exercised. Please do not imitate them in other aspects of their life, because they were not, you know, holding up the ideals which Yahweh has for us. Okay, so it's good to remember that these people are being admired only for that one thing where they trusted God, okay, and acted. They're not being admired for the other fallen areas of their life. Okay, so yeah, we're kind of out of time. But then when we finally, you know, go into the last few chapters, Judges chapter 19 onwards, we see the Benjamites, one example being given of the Benjamites, whose moral standard became so low that they came to the level of the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, if you were to recollect in the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, when the angels went as guests to Lot's house, the men of the city wanted these guests to be brought out so that they can sleep with them, you know, so that they can have sex with them. And at that time, Lot, in his, I don't know what to call it, wisdom or what, he says, I'll give you my daughters instead. You know, you rape them instead of raping the guests. I mean, I don't know what fallen state these people were in. So that is the level to which these Benjamites are reduced. Because here, when, you know, in this particular story, for, you know, we do not have the time to get into it, but we see over here in this city of Gibeah, the Benjamites come and surround the place where the guest and his concubine are staying, and they cry out and say, please bring them out. Bring the man out, because we want to sleep with him. And then, of course, the man decides to send his concubine outside instead. And she's raped the entire night. And it's really sad. In the morning, when they find her dead body, her hand is on the, you know, threshold of the door. She's still kind of, you know, hoping that they'll open the door and let her in. What inhuman beings, you know, the Benjamites were. And then when the rest of the tribes of Israel say, what you have done is really bad, please bring out those evil men of Gibeah so that we can judge them, the Benjamites say, no, why should we bring them out? We'll fight for them. Let's defend them. Like as if these were really great and, you know, honorable people. So it's a very, very terrible story that we see in the book of Judges, where there's no humanity left, no feelings of compassion or morality or goodness. And it's all because these people, you know, decided that they would intermarry with the locals, make covenants with the locals. So what should be the takeaway for us from this book of Judges? You know, it's very nicely put in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 to 17. Sadly, we don't have time to even go there. But then, you know, just to quickly talk about what is there in those verses. 2 Corinthians 6, 14 to 17, it says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. What fellowship can light have with darkness? So no level of compromise is okay. Even a small compromise which light has with darkness will only lead to darkness, more and more darkness. So it's so plain. Do not have any kind of yoking with unbelievers, whether it comes to matters of business, whether it comes to matters of plain friendship, whether it comes to marriage, any kind of yoking where you would have to adjust to their ways, to their values, to their principles. It's so plainly said that we must not yoke ourselves And if you were to continue looking at that, you know, it says, the Lord says, come out from them and be separate. And he says, you know, I will be your God and you will be my people. So we can conclude with this, that in the book of Judges, we see the people going from going to lower and lower levels of degradation because of that compromise they made in intermingling with the locals. And therefore, we of the New Testament are advised not to yoke ourselves with the unbelievers in any way, because it is impossible for light and darkness to have fellowship. On that note, let's close with a word of prayer. Lord, we just thank you so much for the lessons that we can learn from this book of Judges. Lord, you did not do any whitewashing or cover-up job. You showed very plainly how your people behaved and what they did and what became to them because they did not keep your ways. Lord, we most certainly don't want to be like them. Help us, O Lord, to take a strict stand and submit to you, even if it means we will have to be a living sacrifice. Doesn't matter how much we would have to sacrifice on your behalf, but I pray, O Lord, that you would enable us through your Holy Spirit to submit to you and stay loyal to you, so that then we can resist the devil, and the devil will literally have to flee from us, so that, Lord, we can live lives of victory. Lord, enable us to have this kind of a life, O Lord. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.